I'm Martin Hirsch. I'm an application engineer at GenX Laboratory Solutions. And today I will talk about how to start to build Simulink model based on requirements. Why is it so important that we start to build our model based on requirements? We go out to a lot of our customers, and most of them have 10 or more years experience. So we have really experienced engineers who work with Simulink. And still, quite frequently we find models like this. These models work perfectly. They do what they're supposed to do. However, there are some issues with this. One of them is that usually one person is working with that model. And if for any reason that person leaves the company, it will be really difficult for anybody else to continue his work. Another issue is that usually one person works on a model like this. To make it possible for more people to work at the same time on the same model, we need a better structure. Another thing is that if we found some kind of error, if it's not working for any reason, then it will be really difficult to debug. And the last reason is that usually the final product is not the model, it's a SQL generated from the model, and from a well-structured Simulink model, we get a more readable SQL at the end. Now today I will talk about an electronic throttle control system. Here we have three components. We have the pedal, we have the controller, and we have the throttle physical model. These are the three components. If we take a closer look at the controller, then we see that there are some other components inside the controller as well. Today we will talk only about the controller. We are not interested in the other part of the model. Now, how we start to build a model like this? Usually we have some kind of requirements. These requirements could be in Docs, they could be in Word, Excel, PDF, HTML, and so on. Now we open up the requirements. We also open up a new Simulink model, and we just drag and drop empty subsystem blocks into our system. We name this block properly, and we also add some subsystem blocks inside of these subsystem blocks. In this way, at the end, we have a structure that is the same as the structure of our final model. However, clearly this model doesn't do anything yet. The next step is to link each of these blocks to a given requirement. In this example, we do it in Word, so we link each block to a Word document, but we also can do the same thing using Doors. To be able to do that, you need to use this other method. Now, if we linked each model to the requirements, the next step is to start to implement. And here is where the real power of Simulink comes in. So the design engineer, the one who did the requirements, doesn't need to have really deep Simulink knowledge. He can pass on this same Simulink model to the implementation engineers who can develop each block. They add all the inputs and output blocks, and they implement the algorithms, the necessary algorithms. At the end, we have a working model. And the last step is usually SQL generation from this model. Now, the huge advantages of this approach is that because we started from a model which was linked to requirements, we developed that model further by developing it, and at the end generating C code from it, we have perfect consistency. So the final C code is consistent with our model, and the model is consistent with the requirements. We also have perfect traceability. For each line of C code, we can find out which requirements are they linked to. If you're interested, how can you divide a huge Simulink system into smaller models? Or you're interested, how can you build readable models using buses? You're interested in model variants, or you're interested in report generation or version control, please join us at our next training. You can read about the next training under this link. I hope that you enjoyed this video. If you did, please give us a thumbs up. Check out our other videos as well. And see you in the next video. Thank you. Bye.